is a Cosmic Octave original podcast.
Me and Jake running down the street with a handful of comic books kicking ass and banging chicks and drinking beers and smoking weed.
No, not me. I'm married. I'm married.
Jake.
I can't do that.
Yeah. Off panel, off topic with Jake and Tyler.
What's up, everybody? How are you doing, Tyler? We're sitting in a new area. He's sitting in the area.
I got sick of sitting next to you.
It's true. Maybe I think you just want to look at me. I think that's what it is. But yeah, he's sitting where I film my YouTube videos for the channel. Mm. So there you go. Changing things up here for episode number 59.
The thing is, it's probably the way I sit, honestly, but your couch is not good for my back. So,
wow.
So I thought,
you're
going to
come into the Man Cave Studios and you're going to say that shit?
Look at this little whiny. By the way, should we tell the audience about the conversation we were having on off the air about a certain kind of bad word that you can add another word to and just...
Oh, no, that's for us.
Seriously?
No.
Oh.
I mean, we're only a minute and a half in and we're getting to butt fucking. I mean, like...
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about it.
Okay.
Because I feel like we're going to have to spend so much time explaining it and why we think it's funny. In reality, it's just that when you say, like, if you were to say anything that you would normally say, fuck, you put butt...
Like, that's fucking great. Butt fucking great.
You just had a whole other level of like, what did you...
Yeah.
Like, what? What was
Rightly so. Most people in your vicinity should be like, what the fuck did you just say?
Tried it out on my wife. She didn't know anything about... Because it started from a joke that we wanted to do sketches of like fake commercials.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them was Tyler said the joke would have been... Because you know there's a... You better not lay a finger on my butterfinger. We're like, what if it was like fucking? And then Tyler was like, you better not lay a
butt fucking finger on my butt fucking butterfinger.
Yeah, I feel like the second butt fuck was too much. But we've already talked too much about this already. And I feel like...
I feel like the second butt fuck was too much.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm just like...
You better make that
Daddy
a drop.
Chill.
That's just kind of where my mind is, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Let's bring back an old segment.
Because
we have been... Pretty lax on the segment department, so let's get it started.
So fucking long.
It's good though. What's in my mouth? Everybody knows what I'm talking about. So I am trying, I guess we're trying these two. We went to the dollar store and got some really cheap chips. You're not around a mic. Why are you talking? And, okay, this is a shit show, this episode. So I'm trying Herb's Stubbs Sticky Sweet Barbecue Chips. They look like Cheetos, so I'm going to try one. It's weird. I don't know how I feel about it.
Let me have another one. Hang on. Maybe the second one.
I don't know, man. I feel like one is enough. You eat a whole one? Well.
That was my second one.
Why did we think this segment was a good idea on an audio podcast?
You know? I don't know.
I'm going to try some cheap nacho cheese now.
Those are the fucking bomb.
No, they're not.
You're fucking... You're not just fucking out of your mind. You're not just out of your fucking mind. You're out of your butt fucking mind.
I give the Stubbs.
Nice.
Not terrible. Not bad. It's a solid.
Nice.
For me.
Yeah. That's me too.
Nacho cheese, chips. I gotta say.
You are nothing but garbage, yeah. Nothing but garbage, Guyana.
And that's
give me a hell yeah for the garbage nacho cheese tortilla chips. Yes!
Tyler.
Listen, I promise you, I stand by this, and I've stood by it for a long time. They're not always great, but for the money,
like Aldi,
especially
and like
because they were on clearance for like now they were like 50 cents.
No, like Aldi and dollar store and like, you know, off brand, you know, Walmart brand or whatever, you know, the generic nacho cheese. I think that this I think it's great cuz Walmart instead of Cool Ranch it's Glacier Ranch. Mm. Like fucking yeah. Go shut up Walmart.
Fuck you Walmart. Yeah. So speaking
but
of,
I promise you, try those more often because you'll be pleasantly surprised and you'll save yourself a pretty penny.
Speaking of speaking of companies that have been upsetting us, like Walmart, let's talk about Warner Brothers Discovery and Batgirl and all this stuff. So, yeah, first, let's just kind of share what we thought.
Can I have those nacho cheese back?
No. First, I want to kind of just share our thoughts about what we thought about the whole Batgirl situation before we even get into the like nitty gritty of what happened with the conference call and everything else with Warner Brothers Discovery. Mm.
So my first thought was, you know, okay, $90 million. It's in post-production.
Well, yeah, originally it was only going to be like $75 million.
What?
No, but
an extra 15
is because of COVID. COVID is why they had another 15
again, you're already at 75. Shut the fuck up. You know how, I mean, regularly blockbusters cost like $100 million, do they not?
Well, yeah, and this was also being made.
So calm down.
This was also going to be made for HBO Max, and I think had a more modest budget. And then the whole reasoning behind it is taxes. Like, they cannot release this movie for tax reasons. So if they release this movie, they don't get the tax write-off.
And I sense, you know what I sense coming is a weird Batgirl QAnon, Batgirl fan QAnon like Venn diagram intersecting soon. Goddamn Joe Biden is the reason why those goddamn taxes. I can't watch my damn Batgirl movie, damn it.
Jesus.
Sorry.
But what I want to...
Rednecks are loud.
I just want to focus on Batgirl up first because there's a lot more that we're going to get into with how the whole what the reasoning is. It's all cutting costs is what it really comes down to. Is Zaslav wants to cut a bunch of things and he already has, and I think it's also to shore some things up, but we'll talk about that in a minute. In terms of the Batgirl stuff, I think it sucks.
Axing a bunch of other stuff too.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Yeah.
Oh,
sorry.
Well, no, my personal thought is it goes to show you that I hate that corporations are in control of art.
Yeah.
And it sucks that these people have to make this movie for this company, and it's totally fair. You know, like, how do I put this? I get it. Warner Brothers owns this movie. Mm. They didn't like it. They got rid of it. They fired. Throw it away. Yes. Okay. Whatever. Okay. Because that's the reasoning behind it. The reasoning behind it is they're trying to rebuild the DC brand, and it didn't meet their standards. What?
Oh, you fucking aimless fucking dipshits. Just fucking stop. Just give it all to Marvel. Like, seriously. Hey, Kevin.
But Tyler.
Can you help us?
Tyler, how could you be look, I'm not happy the movie got canceled at all. But don't you think it's a kind of a good idea to say, hey, this movie sucked. It's not going to be good for our brand. Or it's not going to be good for DC. I can kind of understand.
That's fair, but why wait till post-production? I mean,
right. Why wait until this movie is done?
It's happened before, I'm sure.
Be released? But no, I don't think I don't think a movie has gotten to this stage and this has happened. I feel like there's been movies that's been shut down shooting, but I don't think there's ever been a situation where a movie has been completed.
The thing is that, you know, I think hardcore DC fans know what they have and they know what they're getting and they know what they're about to get and they're comfortable with all that. And that's fine. You know, they're comfortable with getting a movie, you know, one, maybe two every so often. And some of them are connected and some of them aren't, but that's kind of how the comic books are too. I mean,
well,
I think DC fans are very comfortable with a very loose structure. You know, if you're a hardcore DC comics fan,
excuse me,
Marvel fans are the douchebags about continuity.
Well, no, but I think that's the problem. I think that I feel like they thought that this movie was too confusing because Keaton is in it and it was confusing to audiences. And by the way, this movie got to test audiences. So this was movie with that was already in post-production, screenings, getting ready
Clearly this is a first strike to get rid of the Flash movie because Keaton's in Flashpoint. Because they can't have Ezra Miller on screen at all.
And that's another...
They cannot, not after the shit that just came out.
And that's what I mean. That is another frustrating thing about this. Because you are...
They knew about this shit before they started filming with him, didn't they?
But the reason is they know, or they feel like the Flash is going to be more profitable than Batgirl. And they feel like it's... And they have every reason to, because you have Ben Affleck...
Christopher Plummer to do it.
Listen. They have Ben Affleck in it. They have Michael Keaton in it. Mm-hmm. This is their hinge point. This is their Flashpoint thing of like... We're rebooting this whole universe.
This is their No Way Home fan service.
And I think what they're trying to say is, yes, that Batgirl is supposed to be after the Flash. That's why Keaton is in it. And now we find out that Affleck is in Aquaman 2. So I have no fucking idea what they're doing. And they clearly don't.
No, they fucking don't. So it's kind of embarrassing. And fun to watch.
This is why I played Devil's Advocate, but also showed you that I'm on your side.
Yeah.
I don't care if this Batgirl movie sucked. That's not the point. Like, I understand.
You released Catwoman with Halle Berry.
Dude, Sony released Morbius twice. They had the fucking balls to do that. And you guys don't. And I understand that, but if you're whole like, well, this doesn't live up to our brand, or da 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 da.
Oh, shut the fuck up.
All you had to do.
You don't have a brand.
Well, and then so they're not going to release it in theaters, and then they don't think they can. It will draw in new subscribers on HBO Max.
Fuck your new subscribers. It's a finite number, fuck faces. At some point, you've got everybody.
That's
or you don't.
And that's a great point.
Shit.
And then
that
Tyler, yeah. Tyler, even better. If the movie sucks, if it's as bad as they claim it is, then they could just be like, well, it's an HBO Max movie. But then they run into that problem of like. Well, if it's on HBO Max, is it less quality? So I see both sides of this where DC is in a struggle, like if the movie sucks. But me, as someone that is creative, thinks that at the very least, these people need to have their movie released.
Yeah,
because you're telling me all of that work was for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't matter to you.
Yeah, the model is unsustainable. You got these CEOs who are expecting profits every year. And at some point, you're either going to have every subscriber or you're not. You either have them... And because they want you, or you don't, and they have already made the decision not to.
Yeah.
People are not going to be born and grow up and get their own TVs and devices and shit quick enough for you to fucking
make them
draw
subscriber.
In subscribers that quickly.
It doesn't
so
work.
So your fucking idea that, oh, well, this thing won't bring in new subscribers. Nothing is, fuckface. All you want to do is keep the motherfuckers, because guess what? Guess who let their HBO Max subscription lapse?
Well, I didn't.
I did. Because there's nothing on that I want to watch on there right now.
I'm watching Harley Quinn.
That's fine.
That's about it.
I will get...
I like it. Look, here's the thing. HBO Max is my favorite app.
I have a lot of shows that I watch that are all currently on hiatus.
So it's hard for me to leave it.
I know a season 2 of Winning Time is coming. I know a 4th season of Barry is coming.
I think it's the final season 2.
Yep. I'm pretty sure. Yeah. We Own This City was a limited series, and that's over. What was the other thing that was on there that we were watching?
Our Flag Means Death.
Yeah.
But that's, I don't
that's
know.
That's been over for a while. I assume there's a second one, but with all the shakeups, why don't, you know?
But even then, but circling back to that, that's why I think it's what sucks about when capitalism and corporatism take control of art, because you run into that situation where, again, I can understand what they're coming from in saying, like, yeah, it's $90 million, but we take the tax write-off, so it's, I think they got $15 million. So, yeah, that movie lost them money. But it was able to, it's not a huge number on the bottom line, because...
Whatever numbers they want to give me, it doesn't change the fact that I think it's a stupid decision.
I agree, because at the end of the day, even if it's bad...
Let it be judged, you pussy.
And I could, again... I could also see the other side of it and being like, well, we are tired of DC movies being second class.
Maybe you should stop making them then. What?
To Marvel.
Did I say that out loud?
They want to do more things.
Maybe they should stop making them if they want to stop being second class to Marvel.
Look.
Have I ever told you that?
I don't want to buy into conspiracy theories. because we used to do a podcast.
You think Disney's going to buy HBO?
No. I don't. No. I'm just saying I don't necessarily buy into the. I don't buy into this conspiracy theory that they canceled the movie instead of Ezra's Flash because it's a mixed race lead from a.
Who said that?
There's people online that have this belief that because she was the lead and a female and mixed
they
race.
They do know that corporate hacks and stooges care nothing for
no,
race.
No, exactly. So,
they
but,
care about money and the bottom
that's what
line.
That's what I mean. I don't think it made any difference who the actress was.
No.
I think it was it was just they didn't think this movie was going to make them any money. That's really what it always boils down to, and that's what sucks. Because as a storyteller, no, I agree with you. Why I'm saying I think it's a stupid decision because you're going to piss off creatives. Mm. Because creatives, the whole point,
people aren't going to want to work for you now.
Right, because the whole point of making art of any form is to put it out to the public and have other people enjoy it. And when you are told that you can work on this movie, get it to test screenings, and then it gets cut, that's saying your work doesn't fucking matter to
what
us.
Sucks is that James Gunn is pretty much after Volume 3, he's pretty much going back to like TV for a while, he said.
Yeah, he's doing Peacemaker after Volume 3.
Yeah, and then some. I think he's producing
a couple
things
or something.
Yeah, he's
working on another character.
Yeah. And that sucks because to be really brutally honest, if I could give the keys to somebody for my multiverse, the keys to my multiverse to someone, I'd give it to James Gunn. I'd be like, you work it out. But you know what? I'm willing to bet that James Gunn would be like, what you were doing before was fine. Some stuff's connected, some stuff's not. Just leave it like that.
Well, no, but
that won't change the fact that
the problem
is it wouldn't affect the Batgirl decision because that has nothing to do with that. Yeah,
and
the fact that they're lost in the water has nothing to do with it.
I think the big problem too is they try to build this whole universe. With a director.
Those fucking pictures behind you freak me out. They have no faces.
Oh, my other one.
Some of them have eyes. It's fucking weird. The cyborg
Stop
one.
Stop it. Okay. You're derailing the show. God, this is why you sit.
Green Arrow's got
this
a
is why you sit on the couch, because then you'll get distracted by the pretty colors. Anyway.
Somebody's got red eyes.
But see, I think the problem with the DCEU stuff is they tried to do a Feige figure, but use Snyder. And it's not even talking about his creative vision or anything like that. I'm just saying
circumstances caused him to not be able to.
No, not even that. I'm not even going near that. What I'm saying is you cannot put a director in that position.
No.
Because most of the time that means they're going to direct at least one of those movies and they have to focus all their time on that movie.
Yeah.
And
can you imagine a world?
So it's hard to kind of build a multi-movie cinematic universe behind that.
Can you imagine a world where Christopher Nolan was like, I'm done making movies. Now my project is to bring together the, under one banner, the Warner Brothers DC extended universe. Can you imagine how fucking badass that would be?
Yeah, they made him the producer and made
him
the
fight. For a time.
Yeah, he produced Man of Steel
and
Batman v Superman too. And
I
Justice
believe
League?
This is, I'm pretty sure his name's on there. Probably just for like, here's a couple hundred million.
But at the end of the day, I agree. I understand the business decision behind it, but I also think it's fucked up that these people put in work, and we're told constantly.
I understand.
We're told constantly about how cutthroat the business is, and to have someone get this role, and then it's Leslie Grace, right? Leslie.
I can't remember.
Yeah, but for someone to get that role. And possibly be, even if the movie's bad, maybe their performance is great and that could be leading to something else. Mm. To just throw that in the garbage is just shit.
Yeah.
It's just shitty. It's just, and like I said, you're going to really have to limit yourselves because I don't think most creatives are going to do that.
No. And right now there's a little bit of pushback. I think Scorsese, you know, what he did, I think when these directors and stuff are doing interviews and they decide to badmouth, you know, MCU or superhero movies or whatever, what they're trying to do is make sure that that's not all that's viable.
Yeah,
I totally understand that, and that's why I don't really give them too much grief for it, because it's like, you're just trying to make sure that movies don't all become giant action blockbusters.
Right, and because of that, because of things like that, I've noticed it myself in doing this podcast where I'm like, I'm going to try and start branching out and watching movies outside of the superhero stuff.
Well, fuck that,
and,
man.
and yeah, just watch other, you know, watch other shows,
going through
do
Night Court again.
Other stuff. God, actually, shut up. We've heard enough about fucking Night Court. So anyway, it sucks that... I feel like you have talked more about Night Court than any other person.
I'm going through it again. I want to get to Cheers level.
If that is in your long box, you're kicked off the show.
It's not. I don't know what's in my long box.
Your heart.
You know what?
Also,
our long box this week is going to be Prey.
I wanted to say, here's the full explanation behind Warner Brothers Discovery did what they did.
If it doesn't say we suck.
And then we'll move on. Batgirl found itself on the bad end of that. This is from the article from Variety. Bad end of that decision of getting axed. Apparently neither big enough to feel worthy of a major theatrical release nor small enough to make economic sense in an increasingly cutthroat streaming landscape. Spending the money to expand the scope of Batgirl for theaters plus the $30 to $50 million needed to take it to market domestically and tens of millions more needed for a global rollout could have nearly doubled spending on that film, and insiders say that it was a non-starter at a company newly focused on belt tightening and the bottom line. So that's what...
Tighten this.
He grabbed his balls. Here's a couple more questions after this. I don't think The Flash is getting canceled. I feel like they're going to say fuck it and release that movie and just...
Such a bad
and
idea.
And then just
Such
me...
A
it's
idea.
A bad idea. And I know... Hey, man, You've taken precedent. You've showed us that you can do this now. That's just what you're going to do. So why not kill this fucking movie? Because why are you still going through with two movies that have two very problematic public figures in them? And it's just silly. But we're still going to do that.
And yeah.
But then also, do we think that Blue Beetle is better than Batgirl? Because Blue Beetle was supposed to be on HBO Max. And now it's getting a theatrical release. There's still no release date. So what's stopping that from being getting
That's
axed?
Generally why whenever we hear DC news out of Warner Brothers, Warner Discovery, I'm like, go fuck yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. So other news.
This is what's happening in DCEU. I don't fucking care.
I'll
believe it when I fucking see it in the theater, bro. Or on HBO Max.
But I will say this. This was a little bit reassuring. You know, because I truly think by them doing all this with Batgirl and then just saying fuck it with Flash, because Flash seems to be like a reset point, I think they are trying to make DC worthy of competing with Marvel, which sucks because Marvel's made 20-plus movies at this point. But here's what the new head, David Zaslav, said from the
DC is
earnings call.
One of the top of the list for us. You look at Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, Aquaman. These are brands that are known everywhere in the world. And the ability to drive those all over the world with great story is a big opportunity for us. We have done a reset. We've restructured the business where we're going to focus, where there will be a team with a 10-year plan focusing just on DC. It's very similar to the structure that Alan Horn and Bob Iger put together very effectively with Kevin Feige at Disney. We think that we could build a long-term, much stronger, sustainable growth business out of DC. And as part of that, we're going
to
focus on
Daddy Zaslav.
We're not going to release any film before it's ready. We're not going to release a film to make a quarter. We're not going to release a film under... The focus is going to be how do we make each of these films, in general, as good as possible. But DC is something that we think we could make better, and we're focused on it now.
Okay. This is the third or fourth time that DC
has
said
this. Have I heard
this
before, you fucking jackasses?
However, I do have a little bit of hope in
What's
this.
His name? Salvatore Dali? Salvatore Dipshit?
David Zaslav.
Whatever.
I mean, the dude's a shithead, but...
Yeah, he sounds like one.
Yeah.
Also, I got some speakers in the back if you guys want
what
some.
What they need to do is get...
Tiki Watiti.
See what he's up to. Some other notes to make you more mad at Warner Brothers.
He sounds like a guy, like you're walking down the street in Brooklyn, you know, like you're a tourist. It's your first time there. And he goes like, hey, buddy. And like, you know that if you turn around, you're hurt. You're going to... You're going to go on an adventure.
Yeah.
It's not going to be good.
So, some other notes that we found out.
Hey, pal!
Just before the earnings call is Warner Brothers will be saving $3 billion, that's right, billion, when they merge HBO Max with Discovery Plus.
And we give a fucking shit.
No, I'm just showing you that, like,
oh.
Again, adding to my point of the Batgirl thing, is like, yeah, if you would have released it theatrical, it would have added more to double the cost of what it was or whatever. Mm-hmm. But you just saved $3 billion fucking dollars merging streaming services.
Yeah, and I'm not like
so
most...
you can take, the, even again, even if it sucks and doesn't make its money back at the box office, you could still be like, well, it was a hit. Do you think Disney and Pixar is really that fucking worried that Lightyear flopped? Do you really think that matters?
No.
Oh, man, one of our movies.
Because they probably made it back in merchandising.
That's what I mean. One of our movies that makes all this money wasn't great at the box office, but, again, it doesn't hurt. You know what I'm saying? So, it goes back to, like, you just saved $3 billion fucking dollars, and you couldn't have... Whatever. Warner Brothers Discovery also laid off 70% of HBO Max's staff to merge HBO Max into HBO, because... Mm. For what, and this one makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
As shitty as it is that these people lost their job, it doesn't make any sense that there was a separate division for HBO and HBO Max when they're essentially the same thing.
Or Cinemax, rather.
No, it's not even. It's the fact that like all of the content on HBO that you would get on cable is on HBO Max. In fact, if you sign up for HBO Max with cable or HBO through cable, you get HBO Max with it. So what was the point of having two separate divisions? And yeah. There's a lot of people freaking out about that because then there was a fake report that, and I saw it, I started to believe it, but it wasn't true, that HBO was cutting scripted content. Like, and I was like, first of all, no, they aren't. Are you insane?
Okay.
Excuse me. But like one of the creative leads for HBO that's been there for like all of the hit shows and is responsible for helping getting a lot of HBO shows off the ground and winning awards, he's going to be the new creative director. Like, he's the head of the division. So I think HBO Max is going to be just fine.
Mm-hmm.
And Zaslav also said that they're going to focus a lot on creating content for HBO Max and HBO. He, like, yeah, did that whole thing.
It doesn't suck.
Yeah. I mean, as a whole, HBO is pretty great. Like, original content. It's pretty damn good.
Yeah, well, again, I'm not...
No, I know what you're saying, because you watch a lot of HBO shows. I still need to watch The Wire. No, I can't, dude. I gotta protest and get rid of HBO Max, so I can't watch The Wire.
No, what happened was my card got hacked, and when they were like, hey, you need to change your payment info, I was like, no, I don't.
No.
There's nothing on there that I need right now.
So
plus, I just had to sign up for Hulu to watch this damn Prey movie.
So to recap with all the Warner Brothers Discovery stuff, it's shitty that Batgirl got canceled. I'm still a little hopeful that they're going to do something with the DC universe, but they've been saying that for a while now, so yeah, who knows?
You know, the fool me once, you know, shame on me, fool me
I
twice.
Think they, I'm still,
this
I,
is like the ninth time,
I still
dude.
Think
the
they
ninth
sh-
time.
They should focus on, if they want to try and build a universe, fine, but I still think you and I have said this for many times. Just do solo movies and then maybe have some cameos to connect them somehow.
Yeah.
Or if you're going to do another Justice League movie, just do what they did with the animated movie Justice League War. You jump right into the action. All these characters don't know each other yet, but they're heard of each other. Like, he's like, oh, you're the... He's like, Gotham's my territory when Green Lantern's there, and he's fighting him. And he goes, he's just fighting, doesn't know him. And he goes, oh, looks like you can build... You can focus and build... constructs, and then when he's takes the he like is talking to him and he swipes his ring without him knowing, he goes, what's this made of? And then it disappears his clothes, his costume, so he's in his flight suit. Later on, Batman goes, Hal Jordan, I saw your name tag. You could do that in a movie. That would totally be fine, a Justice League movie, because you and I have talked about it, and mm-hmm. even Zaslav himself says it. You have such iconic big characters that you don't need origin stories. You could literally just throw them in a movie, and an audience would accept it because they know who Batman is, they know who Superman is,
what
they
did
know
we,
who Green
what did
Lantern
we say
is.
About one
they
of
know the Flash.
One of the best MCU openings in a while was Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness.
Because it jumps right in.
Absolutely.
Or Age of Ultron. That's a great opening because it's the event.
It's not a great opening.
Yes, it is. No. You just don't like that movie because fucking Joss Whedon made it.
No, what? Because it's just not.
No, it is.
When was the last time you watched it?
I watched it recently. It still holds up. Like a few months ago.
Okay.
The point is, it just jumps in with the team being the team. And you could do that.
I love James Spader as Ultron, by the way.
No, man. You just don't like it because Joss Whedon sucks. And fair. He is a shitty human.
Yeah, I really, honestly, like, that whole opening sequence is just too...
too many pew-pew quips?
Yes and no. It's just, yeah. I don't know, it just is weird. It's just random and
no,
you're like, what?
Tyler, you can't have a different opinion than me. It's Shut just up, the facts.
Bitch.
All right. Oh, whoa. Okay. So let's talk about Prey. So, this movie, I was excited when I heard the concept of it. Before I'd seen any... footage, like any trailers or anything, I was in the bag because of just the setting for this movie. And
I remember I heard, like some rumblings about it. I'm like, that's cool. That sounds like a good idea.
Because for years, there's been people, like anybody that's been a fan of Predator, I guarantee has said this. You could just drop him in any time period and have a cool Predator movie. It really is just some sort of conflict. Predator drops in.
Predator in the Samurai times.
I saw some of that. I've seen... I saw ones of like like King Arthur, Old England, you know, like Middle Ages. I think there's a fan film that does that, but like
Aztecs.
No, I mean you could
Mayans.
You could really put him anywhere, and it would work. And I think that this movie executes
that.
Cottage
industry.
It's such a brilliant, focused movie, and it's short.
It's a crisp 96 minutes.
It's such a good
crisp
action movie. Such a fun movie. It really it blew my mind how much I enjoyed this movie. Like I was just entertained the whole time.
It's the way that the movie is done and the way it's shot and the way and everything and written and acted. It gives the viewer a lot of credit. Which is what makes movies good.
Yeah, you don't see a lot of movies that really make you pull in and focus.
I think at one point they say, like, the Great Northern Plains, 1719, and that's, like, the only exposition you really get. And that's all you really need. I mean, you're aware, if you went through public school, you're aware of the fact that there were Native Americans once upon this land, and so on.
Yeah,
so,
hence their name being Native, because they were here.
Right, but the thing is the way that it's just portrayed is, again, it like we were just talking about with, you know, dropping you right in the action. It doesn't drop you right in the action, but it does drop you right into a place and expects you to just be like, hey, this is the way things are done.
Within the first 10 minutes.
And we're not going to do a bunch of exposition about how they live. We're just going to show it.
In the first, like, 10 minutes, you see the Predator ship.
Yeah.
Because it's literally the Predator ship, and there's a really cool transition where it scrolls down, and it just says
that
prey
was awesome.
In the sky, and then it just scrolls back down. Like, it was just, there's so, like, the cinematography is so good in this movie.
So beautiful.
I even commented on it when I was watching it with my wife. I was just like, it's shot really well.
When they drop the Predator off, that whole sequence, I really liked how they... because it starts, it's right after maybe 10 minutes in or whatever. But it's where the ship just kind of drops in and goes visible for a second and then goes invisible and takes off. And then you see the Predator stand up. They basically just dropped him off. And there's that whole valley. He's on that cliff overlooking that valley. And I thought it was really great that they just gave the viewer... You're not even thinking about it, but you're memorizing this tableau. You're memorizing this view. And it pays off about 20 minutes later when she goes back out to hunt and she makes camp on that exact fucking cliff where they dropped him off.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, cool, because... That's another way of telling you that she's near his lair or that she's near him without saying, like, you know, I really liked how there wasn't the words were the action told the story a lot more than the script did, which I really liked.
Yeah.
Sorry, was it boring you?
There was not a ton of dialogue.
What was that?
I had a point to make, but I wanted to let you finish.
Such a bastard.
How dare I not speak and interrupt you and let you talk? What a novel idea.
Ladies and gentlemen, he was lollygagging his head to the side with his tongue out like, good God.
Yeah, get to your fucking
How long
point.
Are you going to fucking talk? Okay. Oh, now you got to cough. Well, okay. I'll vamp.
Yeah, keep going. Fucking dick. Anyway. Okay. Any Hoosiers.
We had to stop for a fight.
Yeah. And the point I was going to make is gone. Just into the ether. Gone. Because you had him pointed out.
We were talking about the tap, the scenery. Okay.
I know. No, that's one of the themes that I really love about this movie is the theme of these two are constantly within proximity of each other, but they don't finally meet until the third act of the movie. Mm. And that's brilliant. There's even a part where he would have killed her, but he didn't see her as a threat. And like, oh, by the way, shit, I forgot.
Whatever.
Oh, no, hold on. We got to.
We will.
We got to do it. We got to do it.
Fine.
Pizza time.
Yeah.
We're in spoilers now. Sorry. Even though we definitely talked
we
about
it. We do need to do it because it's kind of our thing.
Yeah.
I knew that we hadn't before we started talking about it, but I was like, you know what? If you listen to this show, you know we're not going to waste much time.
Yeah.
I mean, there really isn't any
pizza
point.
Pizza time.
Just in case.
Sorry if you've...
But no,
we didn't really spoil it too much anyway.
What I really liked about this movie, too, is you're right. There's not a ton of dialogue, but we still get a ton of visual, environmental storytelling that builds up these characters.
If you know anything about history of the Americas, you know that there were French trappers and stuff. And, you know,
when they
show up and they're speaking French... You know what they want and stuff.
I think they do a really great job of showing the struggle that these early American civilizations had as hunter-gatherers.
Yeah.
And where, yeah, now we do it as sport. They were doing it for
survival.
Fucking
buffalo just for their pelts. And how, I mean, you think
we'll get to that.
Yeah, oh,
we'll
man.
Get to that.
Do we have to, yeah. Don't get me started.
Well, I know, but I wanted to finish making my point. But... What they did with Amber Mid Thunder and her storytelling was great. But what I also really loved is how the predator was learning how to keep stepping up the hunt, how to keep getting the bigger predator each time. Because we see this really cool shot. I will say some of the animal CG didn't look the best in this movie, but
no. But I'm willing to forgive it.
The really,
it really
cool shot
looking.
With the
when they went
the,
from one
the
to
rat,
the next,
and you see the rat going around. And then you see, yeah,
the snake
a
gets
snake attack.
Well, first it eats the fly.
Yeah,
then the snake
then
gets the yep.
Yeah, you see how nature works.
Yeah.
And then to see the predator finally
the wolf,
kill the snake.
Chasing the rabbit was cool, too.
Oh, my God. That wolf scene was fucking
right?
awesome. Yeah. And again, there's so much of this movie that is great, and it doesn't waste any time. You literally, like, okay, here's Amber Mid-Thunder, her tribe, her story that she's, you know...
It's pretty straightforward.
They're
going to
meet at some point.
Hey, guess what? Ancient civilizations like this one, they, you know, women generally did this and men generally did this. So you can tell right off the bat that she's not happy doing the women's work. You know what I mean? What I mean? Like, and that's fine.
And I will say this, and I will only address it for this part.
But it's very obvious right away. You know, it's not. Yeah.
And anybody that says this movie is like some woke or feminist agenda are just fucking losers and don't validate their opinion.
Hey, is this the eighth Predator movie before we had a female lead?
I think this is... If you count AVP...
I mean, you know, I want to talk about that
no,
CBR
yeah, listen,
article
listen,
later.
If,
but yeah.
if you count AVP, it's the seventh movie. So it's this finally in the seventh movie of the franchise.
You goddamn woke bastards, it took you... You know what? I remember when I saw the first Predator in 1987.
No,
I was like, before you know it, in 40 years, they're going to have a...
What I'm saying is it doesn't matter. It doesn't. It really wouldn't matter if it was a man or a woman in the role.
No.
Like, her being a woman doesn't even add to that because she says she just does it because people don't...
But her performance, you can't replicate.
In their societies, women could hunt. If they were good enough, women could, if they thought that they could do it, they would do it.
Sure, it was clear, like, when she was talking to her brother that she could have a... What was it? Katamilia? Amalia? Mia?
Yeah, the, like, rite of passage.
Or something? Yeah, the hunt. That final adult hunt or whatever. When they were talking, it was clear that she could take one. It's just that... You know, I mean, clearly by the actions and the words of like the other tribes guys, the other hunters, when they were all together, were like, you know, she doesn't know anything because she's a woman.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that.
So what this could have also been titled was Prey, colon, the Predator versus Animals, because this, not only does he fuck up a wolf, he fucks up a bear, too.
Dude, I, you know, speaking of the CGI, I completely and totally forgive all of the wonky CGI during that moment. That scene had a couple of...
Which one?
The bear fighting scene.
The bear one looked bad.
It looked pretty bad. There were
but I loved it. I was in
right?
it.
Right? I was like, I don't give a shit.
It did not break my immersion at all.
Right. I remember reading something about... I remember I read a spoiler-free review, and it was talking about how Amber Midthunder and Dakota Beavers were really good, and how, except for some questionable CGI, it's like a five-star movie, you know? And I remember reading about that, and I think... I knew that there was a couple of CGI shots, I think... The one we were talking about with the rabbit and the, or with the rat and the fly and the
yeah.
I think there were a couple parts during that, but then the bear was like very obviously I'll, like look, oh this is what they were talking about
for me.
But who gives a shit?
For
it
me,
was fucking
I,
Predator wrestling a bear.
I know. I've always been look, and I'll agree. I wish we could have done it with real animals, just because I'm always someone that
sure
that like
yeah.
I feel it's silly to see, but I understand like they don't want to have any problems with.
Well,
be,
you'd have to train a bear
it's a
to get
it's
murdered
a liability.
By yeah.
It's a liability, and there's no
it's
way.
Not
there's
worth
no
it.
Way you could shoot picking up the bear. There's no way you could shoot that. You have to CG that. There's no way. But anyway.
But yeah, totally forgiven.
So yeah, let's.
It was so I was so
I wanna,
on the
I
edge
wanna,
of my seat that I didn't give a shit.
I want to talk about the Predator fighting non-humans. I do want to talk. I just want to talk about him fighting the wolf and the bear before we talk about anything. Because the kills in this movie are brutal, are nasty, and they're fucking awesome. And this
dude, that
this,
net
so,
that he uses on the fucking
when he
fur
burns
trapper,
him into the ground through.
No, it was a fucking net that just contracted and was made of steel, and it just contracted and made him into fucking hamburger, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a little thing on the bottom but of the rock,
the wolf,
and it just
the wolf fight was insane. Because first of all, Ashley and I agree, it's bullshit that he stays invisible when it's hand-to-hand combat.
Yeah, fuck you, dude. I was just saying, you know what? The Predator isn't all that much of a sportsman.
Yeah, because he stayed invisible.
Dick.
If the very least, if you're one-on-one fighting the thing, you should take your cloak off and fight it. But no, yeah, that whole sequence is gnarly because, again, it's the second time we see the rabbit, then we see this wolf fucking eat this rabbit, and then boom. Then, but when he finally gets the rabbit, and then the Predator comes out of nowhere and tackles it, that was awesome.
Yeah,
and again, that's what's so cool is that visual environmental storytelling showing the food chain right in front of him, so he knows. Okay, I go after the wolf.
There
I
were
fight
a lot,
the
there
wolf.
Were a lot of storyboard. There were a lot of sequences you could tell were storyboarded, and like okay, we got to show it like this and this and this. For added effect, there were a couple of frames during that wolf thing that were like, you know, the CGI. But again, I don't give a shit.
I think the wolf looked fine. I think the most egregious one was by far the bear.
Absolutely. But dude, who cares? It was so good.
You can't shoot that scene with a real bear.
No,
you can't.
No. It was so good, I didn't give a shit, really.
But that
I was terrified when I realized how easy it was for that bear to climb up to where she was. I was like, oh, shit.
People forget that bears can climb very fast.
Yeah, fucking shit.
Well, that's what I mean. And again,
fucking shit, Uncle Clem.
It's cool to see this thing fight apex predators. It's fun. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, that was cool.
Ashley was like, I remember sitting there and we were watching it, and it is kind of like, because the whole time I'm watching, she has Sari, her dog. Is it Sari? Or
Sari.
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 And Naru is her character name. Yeah. That dog was great. And beautiful dog acting.
Very good boy.
Apparently they adopted that dog and it had no training before the movie, so they had to train it while they're doing it.
Very good boy.
But the whole time I'm like, please don't tell me he's going to kill that dog. And then
I'm really glad the dog made it.
Yes,
yeah.
Me too. And then at the end,
I hate it when they kill
then
a dog.
And then after I have those thoughts,
looking at you, Turner and Hooch,
it goes to the wolf scene where he just fucks up that wolf, and then I was like, oh Jesus, when he cuts the head off
right.
And actually pulls out the spinal column.
But speaking of,
but again, that's a good throwback to the original movie,
right? Speaking of the really cool like CGI, like you know, you know, Nature's Way or whatever shots.
Yeah.
What about the really cool POV shot of the hawk getting hit by the arrow? When her and Tabe
are
both hunting, he's just like, fuck you. And she was like, I was waiting for it to circle back. But there's a moment
you have to cross the river
where the bird is just flying along and then, phew, and it's like, they did a lot of that with the Predator's arrows too, which was kind of cool.
Oh, and that's another thing I like.
Like POV shots and whatnot.
About this too, with this Predator, it is a different, because in the comics, and I haven't read them because I'm going to go off on a little diatribe here. Fuck Marvel, okay, because all of the Dark Horse comics are not available online, and I went on Comixology because this is what I'm saying. This is why this is a great movie, because it reignited my love for this franchise. Mm-hmm. So I was going to go on Comixology and see if there were some books I could pick up, and because I never read the Dark Horse books, and everybody loves those books.
Yeah, they were fantastic.
But now Marvel owns the license, so I can't look at them digitally. The only way I could do it is hopefully get them on a deal at a comic shop somewhere.
Mm.
But I was just like, that's fucking shitty, because now I know they're going to re-release them and they're going to jack up their prices because they own the IP now.
Well, doesn't Disney have like the Digimon license, but they're not doing anything with it, but they also won't sell it?
Well, clearly they know that
Disney has a shitload of properties that they're not doing anything with.
Yeah.
But they won't sell them.
But that's what I mean is like, that's what sucks is I know that they know.
I don't give a shit about Digimon.
That they can make Predator a viable franchise again. So you know they're going to resell those comics and then shoot up the price, and I'm going to be like, fuck you. But anyway, in the comics, they do establish...
Black Heroin.
They establish the name. I don't know how to pronounce it. I think it's Yatu is the name of the species. And they are, like we saw in Predators, you haven't seen it, but in Predators, they set up a storyline that there are two warring tribes on the planet, which is also in the comics.
Uh-huh.
And so what we're seeing in this movie is a more primal version of that species, of the Yatu or whatever, because even his helmet is just a skull with a laser on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was smart to make him more low-tech than the Predator that we've seen in other movies.
Yeah.
Because then it's really going to break your...
Although he had a badass shit, dude.
But he still had
some cool shit.
But I love that they kept the signature blades, and they still gave him some really cool tech. But his, like, he literally, most you see of him was with a collapsible shield.
That thing was cool too.
And oh god,
especially when he was going after her, and that moment was like,
that
fuck.
Was insane. That right? Shot was insane.
Her neck's like that fucking. For you're
but,
like, oh.
But let's wrap up talking about the bear fight.
No,
I want to talk about again, what this movie does so well. Yeah. It's like you and I were talking about earlier. It really makes you feel...
It's very visceral.
Dangerous at all times. But that's what it was like living at that time.
Yep.
Like that mountain lion scene. And this is what's so brilliant about it. They set it up as being the Predator, but it's a fucking mountain lion instead, and it's still horrifying. Like, that was so good.
Same thing with the bear.
Right. And that's what I was getting to. The bear sequence... When he's fucking
dude,
climbing,
you know
at her, I'm like, Jesus
right. That
Christ.
That time, well, first he couldn't do it, so then he's like, well, I'll just go around, which was like even more terrifying.
Yeah, because bears are smart.
Dude, yeah, the shot where he's climbing up and the dog's trying to bark and get his attention.
I'm like, don't kill the dog. Don't kill the dog.
But, dude, that time, living in that time, was the literal definition of fuck around and find out.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to pretend to hunt. Well, that thing killed you now. How do you feel?
Which mainly makes you think
dumbass.
Of, like, the shit your ancestors had to deal with.
Right?
Just to keep your bloodline going.
We are pampered little punk
yes.
asses.
It did. Let's...
Oh, so you don't have to fight for your meals? You fucking pussies.
I got to say, let's transition and talk about Amber Midthunder for a bit before we talk about the Predator again.
Because
we haven't even got to him fucking eviscerating. You know what? Fuck it. Let's talk about him eviscerating those French dudes. Holy shit.
That was
awesome.
Cool. Mainly because you realize, as a student of history, you realize that Europeans coming over to this continent was the worst thing that ever happened. Granted, to this continent. Granted, I wouldn't be here. But these fucking fucksticks literally would skin animals and then leave them dead.
Yeah, and...
They wouldn't kill them.
They wouldn't take
anything
else.
They
set that up in the movie to make you think the Predator did it.
Right, but as soon as they did, I was like, there's skulls.
See, but that's the thing.
And he wouldn't do that many.
No, he wouldn't even bother. They're not a threat to him.
Well,
they're not a predator.
What led me to believe, to understand it wasn't the predators, was A, they still have their skulls, and B, there was more than like one of them. And it's like, you only need one, right?
And again,
and then she found the cigar.
He wouldn't see those buffalo or whatever they, you know.
Right, he probably wouldn't.
He wouldn't view them as predators.
Probably wouldn't, yeah.
So he would leave them.
I mean, when you realize like how fucked up that was, that like nobody was, how many types of animals did they extinct just by, oh, we need to get these to the market for rich ladies. You know, it's like, fuck you.
And I love that they only spoke in French and they never subtitled it. Because, again, it puts you in the shoes of Neru, and, like, she wouldn't understand what they're saying, so you don't know what they're saying.
It's very effective because you really have to...
It's disorienting,
You have to find the clues in the pantomime, what they're doing, their body language. And because I can't understand French.
Mm-hmm.
That was really, really cool. I really liked how they peppered... the language. I wish they would have spoke. I'm going to have to watch the Comanche version just because I love the language.
Yeah,
it was such a neat... Did you try to follow along when they were speaking on the subtitles?
Yeah. Like, I want to go back and watch it with, the Comanche with, like, the Comanche dub with subs on it.
Because the...
Ashley said we should have watched it that way, and I was like, yeah, but...
Yeah, I watched...
I'd already started the movie.
So I watched just the regular version or whatever, so when she would... So I watched with subtitles. So when they were speaking English, it would say in English.
Yeah.
And then they would show in
the Comanche. Yeah.
And the thing was, you could see how it was spelled and everything and all the umlauts and whatnot. And it's very bizarre because, okay, a word like, because, okay, say like a phrase, a phrase, I was there, right?
Yeah.
Or I was walking, right? Walking is two syllables. So you would say, I was walking, right? But the way that they do it was, the way that their words trying to follow along, it was more like, I was walking. And it was like the way they spoke the words was just really fucking broken up and shit compared to like how it was spelled. It was as a musician.
Oh my god.
I fucking hate you.
Amber Mid Thunder was great in this movie.
I loved her. Her eyes really made her performance.
She did
really
a lot of physical work in this movie. Yeah,
compared to a lot of other people in the movie too. She had bigger eyes, I think, like compared to. And a lot of the hunters like had face paint and whatnot, but when she was like wide eyed, the whites of her eyes were like so prominent.
I think it's cause she had the black paint.
Maybe. Yeah. But I mean, that was one thing about her performance that like, especially when her brother got the war chief thing and she was just staring at him, like you could feel the emotions that she was going through just in that stare, which I thought was cool.
Yeah. And again, for people that say like she was a Mary Sue or whatever, clearly didn't watch this movie because
she's a what?
A Mary Sue.
What's that?
She's overpowered. How do you not know what a Mary Sue means? Mary Sue is when a character like Rey in Star Wars seems to just know how the fucking Force works and can grab a Force lightsaber.
Why is it Mary Sue, though?
I don't know the fucking origins of the fucking phrase, all right? Jesus Christ. Point is...
fucking pissed.
Because you should know...
fucking know!
You should know what these terms are!
The fucking phrase... Fucking Mary Sue, man.
Well, because you fucking fucked me on the point I was trying to make. Anyway.
She's not a Mary Sue, cuz.
Yes, she's not overpowered and isn't... She fails constantly in this movie. She couldn't kill the mountain lion. Her brother did it. If anybody's a Mary Sue, it's her brother, because he's great at everything he
does. Yeah, he's like a mystical warrior.
Which, again, makes her story, I think, more compelling, because she is trying to be like, I can do this. I'm not you, but I know there's something going on. There's something else. And
I think the best thing was I think one of them said, "Why do you want to prove that you can hunt so much?" And she said, "Because none of you think I can."
Which
is a very good reason.
Which I don't think is a woke plot line, because you could stick any person, any gender.
Hey, Tyler.
Because everybody has had that feeling of trying to prove someone wrong.
Hey, Tyler. Why do you want to release albums so much? Because none of you think I can.
Exactly. Exactly. Anyway.
Got very excited just now.
I think she did a great job of showing that raw tenacity of what it would be like to live in that era. And
there's one review that talked about how she used a lot of her body language to tell the story, which mm-hmm. was very true. And her parents are, I think I told you this, her parents are stunt performers.
Yeah.
Which is like, okay, fair.
Well, dude,
that makes total sense.
You know, another scene that I think is what's so great about this movie is it builds legitimate tension out of its timepiece, out of its time period. Because again, living in that time fucking sucked. And I don't know how people did it. I don't even know how people live without TV, to be honest. But, but I think, like, for example, the mountain lion situation, or when she's in that sink pit and you think she's going to drown in the mud. And, like, that's such a great moment of her pulling herself out of it. And,
you know, and surviving. By the way, Dan Trachtenberg, way to fucking misdirect me, man. I literally was like, oh, that's how she finds out she can hide from the predator.
Right.
Nope.
That's exactly what I said to
nope.
Ashley. I said
it's
the same thing.
It's a fucking flower, dude.
I
yeah.
said the same thing. I said that's how she's going to learn in the mud.
Right.
Yeah.
I was like, cool, because
that'd
about
be a callback
to
the first movie. So that was great. I thought
we're
this
right there, man.
Yeah.
But then it fakes us out because it was like, no, it's a flower, and it was like, oh, that's even cooler.
Yeah. Well, and that's another thing too.
And when she kills the fucking yeah, we'll get to that.
Is her her learning out that people still don't think after all that she's done that she's a threat. And she provides, and she, every rightfully so, because she had a chance to kill the predator and couldn't. But then she finally learns to use the flowers and use things that she already knew with her medicine to outsmart the predator.
The part where the French trappers catch her back in the camp, which she goes back to rescue Sadi. And they catch her, and she, like...
just murders four dudes.
Right, but, like, for a little while, it's touch and go. Like, you know, because she's... one person against four guys with, like, you know, guns and knives
and
shit, right?
About to kill her dog.
Ruthless
savages.
Fuckers, right? Yeah. So for a second, you know, for a couple of seconds, it's touch and go. And then she gets the upper hand, you know, just by pure force of will. And finally gets her fucking tomahawk going.
Which
with
was
the,
such
with the,
a cool weapon.
Right?
Who would have thought?
You need a leash for your weapon. Like, yeah, well, you're about to get hacked in half,
dude,
bro.
When the predator takes that axe and flips it and chops that dude, I was like, holy shit.
There were a lot of cool kills in that movie, dude.
Well, yeah, she's great, and she does such a great job that you are really rooting for her to kill the predator at the end of the movie.
Oh, yeah.
And the way that she kills him by using his own tech against him.
Perfect.
Genius. And then she has
and of course there's
she
those
has
assholes.
A line from the first movie that, come on, come on. Like,
come on.
Do it.
And we talked about how her brother gets to say, if it bleeds, we can kill it. Which, by the way, was said, the script was written so well that even
though
you knew.
I totally forgot he said that.
Even though you knew it was coming, I knew it was coming, you know, like, okay, what they're talking about and stuff. It was delivered with sincerity, and to be really honest, it wasn't like so many of those callbacks can just be such a big wake.
I think they were smart in only having a few. Yeah,
you know, like you can almost feel the movie going like, ah, you see my eye, I winked. You're like, yeah, we fucking got it.
But
okay?
And that's another thing I love
but
too.
Not this one.
Another thing I love too is they actually showed the process of him using the acid to clean the skulls. Because you'd seen it here and there, but you've never actually seen it evaporate. I was like, oh, that was cool.
I hope by the time he got done, he's like, the skull's kind of puny.
What, and again, what this movie exceeds at doing and what the first movie does really well, and the second movie's fine. But I think this movie and the first part are doing a great job of playing by the Jaws rule of not really showing him until the end.
Yeah, yeah.
And we see glimpses of this predator throughout the movie, but we don't really fully see him until he fucks up the traders, which is awesome. But and that's, I think, a great way to...
Traders, not traitors, by the way. The French dudes. Okay.
The French fur trade.
For a second, I thought you said traitors, and I was like...
Traders.
No, I know what you meant.
The scalp.
But I thought, so I...
Not scalpers.
Passed it along. Fur traders.
Fur traders, there you go.
Those butt fuckers. You know what? There probably was a lot of butt fucking going on. Yes. You know, they're stuck away from their wives. I've had too much wine. Jacques.
Jake? But you said Jacques.
It's you said Jake, dude. I don't know, man.
You talking to me?
Not there's anything wrong with that.
But I think that's what makes a good Predator movie is really waiting to really... Because we know what the Predator looks like. Mm-hmm. And you can have different... And I like that this is clearly a different Predator than what we're used to seeing.
That fucking net, though, man. Fuck.
Well, and then the when it,
cause there's
when
one
when he's following the tribe though, and they has the lasers on him, and you and I both thought this, it's gonna be a blaster, and then it was the fucking arrows, and
but
I'm like,
then
oh,
the,
shit.
But then the dots started moving apart.
Yeah, and I was like, wait, what?
Yeah,
and then,
right,
foom,
dude.
Foom, foom, foom.
Dude, when he was riding around him on the horse and like just.
Yeah,
you know, just fucking, you know, dodging the things or whatever. It was like, yeah, this is cool, man. When she ends up, when she gives up the French dude, and while he's, you know, involved with hacking that dude, she just comes up behind him and fucking blows his fucking head off with the pistol and shit, and steals his helmet. And there was so much, you know, I can't remember all the shit she said in the speech that she gives to the guy, but she's like, you know, you don't see me killing you. And he won't either, and it won't either, or whatever.
Yeah.
It was like, God damn, that's just cool.
Well, before
she
that,
she takes the gun and she just
also
puts her own face paint on in front of him.
Also, if anybody wants to complain about her again, oh, how could she beat a Predator? The Predator was severely wounded. Okay, because he fights the brother. The brother's kicking his ass because he jumps up, sticks a spear through his chest.
Yeah,
and then,
the brother takes him pretty hardcore to the ground.
Again, her brother is the real Mary Sue because he gets the advantage on this Predator before the Predator.
Oh, and don't forget that you know, before they got hacked to pieces, the other hunters like get a couple arrows in him.
Yeah,
you know, and he doesn't have complete armor all over everything.
Yeah. He's not.
He gets hit with at least one or two arrows during that moment when he first shows up, and she's got her hands tied.
But that whole sequence is great, and that fight with her brother, and then like the getting him stabbed to the chest. I was like, because I knew he was gonna die. I was like, shit.
Duh.
But then that fight, and then the Predator cuts its own fucking arm off with his shield. I was like, what?
That was cool.
Because it was stuck
shit.
In the. Because
yeah.
It was stuck, and it was like, fuck it. And it just chops its arm off. I'm like, damn,
dude.
That's another thing. It was a one-armed Predator. That's how she beat it. If you want to be, a shitbag about it.
Prime Purple People Leader.
But the fur trader scene, when he takes that fucking bear trap and chucks it at that guy and just cuts his head, like just explodes his head. I was like, Jesus.
There were so many cool kills in that moment. And the cool thing about, I mean, not the cool thing.
Yeah, but he shoots that net on that guy and it just turns him into nothing. Like,
well, yeah. Because
it burns right through the log. I was like, shit.
Oh, dude. So, and then nothing's left but just meat.
Yeah. Or when he takes the fucking shield and chops that dude's head off and chops down the tree at the same time.
Fuck.
I was like, dude, this movie is awesome.
Yeah, there's
so many good kills. Mm. And I was like, oh. Like, Ashley was like, we were sitting there, and that's one where I popped when I laughed because I was just like, that was incredible when he threw that fucking bear trap and just turned that dude into meat.
Yeah,
like,
just.
Jesus.
It was so much. And
well, the wolf fight, too, made me go, holy shit.
Yeah.
And then the bear fight, I was like, Jesus Christ. Because the bear fight, this shows you, and God, I love this movie, but this shows you how cocky this Predator is, because you can tell it's a younger Predator.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's sitting there, and he's, like, the bear is raining blood on him, and it's covering up his cloak, and he's just sitting there going like,
yeah.
Like, he's like this psychopath. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's like,
it's like Andy Dufresne.
Give me the blood.
It's like Andy Dufresne washing himself clean.
I'm a little mad.
Shawshank Redemption.
I don't like how it ended, though, because we didn't have a weird laugh from the Predator. And then an explosion. No, but the ending is great.
You know, the guy who plays the Native American character in Predator, have you heard about this? I cannot remember his name, but he plays Billy.
Yeah, yeah.
So Billy. They actually had to hire security to protect the rest of the cast from him. Sonny Langham, to protect the rest of the cast from him. Because he was, like, notoriously, like, dangerous.
Wow.
Yeah. And then everybody got dysentery. Yeah. That was not a fun, from all accounts, working on the first Predator movie was not a fun.
No, especially because they had to redesign the creature after they started shooting.
Yeah. My name is Jean-Claude Van Damme. If you cannot see Jean-Claude Van Damme, then I am not Jean-Claude Van Damme in the movie.
And I'm also, I look like a fucking lobster, so. Like, the first design did not look good. Overall,
but regardless, it covered up his face, which you should have thought
so
about.
So the
dipshit.
Ending of this, when she, I love the ending how she kills him.
Did
and
we get through this?
Uses his helmet.
Yeah.
And then she, the pistol that she had, is the pistol that was on the ship in Predator 2.
That they give to Lieutenant Mike Harrigan.
Which worries me, because that also means if there's a sequel, they're probably going to kill her whole tribe. Because how else did they get the pistol? They're going to show up, or at the very least, because if you watch the end, did you see the little painting?
I did.
And you saw the ship come back?
It's been said online that, yes, that refers to three ships coming to... Yeah. So there's definitely a sequel coming.
Maybe. We don't know. That was clearly a tease. I think this... No, because I think this did huge numbers on Hulu. This was also on Disney Plus, and I think it did...
Really?
Yeah.
Why didn't you tell me that? I wouldn't have signed up for Hulu.
I thought you knew. Sorry.
No, it's okay. Only Murders in the Building is back, so I need to watch season 2.
There's some good shows on Hulu.
Fuck you.
All right.
They have all seven seasons of Just Shoot Me.
I will say, though, I am a little bummed that this didn't go to theaters, because I feel like this would have been a perfect movie to watch in a theater.
The cinematography easily.
But I think...
Screamed theater.
I think that Disney was trying a different approach because... That the Predator franchise had been so much like Terminator, I think a lot of people were disinterested. Mm-hmm. And so they had to do something drastic, and they thought, hey, if this doesn't work out, at the very least, it's just on Hulu or Disney Plus.
Did you see the director of Dark Fate came out and said he wished he wouldn't have done the movie?
Yeah, I did. I did see
that. Thanks for making the movie, dickhead.
Well, I know it's for your long box. You can talk about the comic book resources article.
Yes.
So we'll get to that. It's time. Okay. Well, overall, I think both of us really, really love the movie.
Oh, we both give it a yes.
You could clearly. It was one of those movies where I really can't wait to watch it again. Like, well, I really want to rewatch it.
It was a lot like No Way Home and Batman and The Batman. Like, it's just movies that just are so well done, you know,
yeah.
And not comparing them to them.
There's so much thought and care put into this movie.
You can't really compare those three. I'm saying, like, our reactions to those three, mm-hmm. like, it definitely was not like The Eternals. Where we were trying to convince ourselves that we liked it and then ended up realizing, oh, I didn't really like that movie after all.
I still think you liked it.
I do, because I have more connection
God
to it.
God damn it. I'm tired. For a movie that I don't like, we bring it up too much. But I will say this.
See, Patton Oswalt said there's an Eternals 2 coming out.
Yeah, he just casually said that. So, you know, we look at the movies that I've seen this year that have come out this year. Mm. And I'm someone who actually was someone that liked Multiverse of Madness. I still liked Love and Thunder.
I did too.
But honestly, I think this might be my favorite movie of the year. Like, I really, really like this movie.
Mm.
We'll see how Wakanda Forever is, but I think of all the movies that we cover or have covered for this show, this is probably my favorite of the year right now.
You know what? Mine too, and I'm sure Wakanda Forever is going to blow my mind.
Yes.
But you know what else I've seen is that there's a Lego set coming out called King Namor's Throne Room.
Oh, my gosh.
Which means I'm finally going to have a fucking Submariner minifigure. God damn it, with little green shorts and everything and pointy little ears.
I do like that they
so excited.
I do like that they made Namor
Aztec.
Yeah.
Can I say they're getting a sexier voice? Aztec.
Yeah.
That's my sexy voice.
Now it's time for the
box.
Yeah. So Tyler, what do you want to talk about today?
I want to talk about Wangs. Oh no.
Actually the opposite of Wangs. Based on this article.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Trying to set you up again, bro.
For a second, I totally forgot what I was talking about. Okay, so
MCU.
Yeah, so we've talked about CBR.com, comicbookresources.com, quite a few times, because I like to, for a long time, I would just, when I was bored, I would look online and I would go to that website and they have these lists. Like top 10 like sitcoms of all time and shit, and they were good.
What? I also use them for show
trying
prep.
Trying to fuck up my long bones.
No, I'm just saying I also use them for show prep. They're a good
book. Oh yeah, yeah. Their resources are pretty great. And they're generally, I guess they're more I don't really understand newspapers and conservatism, but I definitely CBR definitely has more of a left leaning slant, which is right up my alley. again, I'm not sure when being a human being, but I digress.
any sane person.
Yeah, being a human being. But anyway, is being left-leaning, but whatever. no, I mean, come on. What is?
Get your fucking exactly. point,
Thank
guy.
You. Let's move it on there, Mr. SJW. Okay. So I was reading, it's on my Facebook feed, and I'll see different articles, and I saw a headline that was like, is the MCU becoming the MCU? Well, some fans might not be happy about it. And I was like, God damn it, CBR.
Yeah.
Like, how fucking dare you pander to this bullshit, right? And I opened the article, and it was by, excuse me, I took a soda.
It was by a whammon? By a woman, isn't it?
It was by written by Savannah Peterson, and I can't remember the exact title of the article, but it refers to the MCU. And you and I have talked about on the quartering that douchebag and how he was like, it's Thor's weapon."
Tiki with TD.
Yeah, where is that shit, man?
It's over here.
Get the soundboard ready.
Point is this: he's him and Geeks and Gamers and all those fucking anti-fandom losers. They're all like.
Yeah, they're grifters.
Pew pew quip. Pew pew quip. Yes, they're pop culture grifters. But yeah, they
they're the pop culture equivalent of Ben Shapiro.
Pretty much. Nerdrotic does it. The MCU and Geeks and Gamers. All those fucking losers say it.
So I was understandably, before I read the article, I was like, God damn it. Like, don't cater to this shit.
Yeah.
And I've never really known CBR to do that. They're fairly balanced and objective. Again, they do tend to lean left, but again, whatever. So the article was talking about, like, you know, assholes. It took that's not the word she uses. That's the word I use. But you know, it took like three phases for us to get our first woman-led, you know, MCU movie. And we were talking about earlier.
It wasn't until after Black Panther
that there was a first African American lead.
Oh, sorry, yeah. From
was Black Panther
from Iron Man to Ragnarok, they're all led by white men,
right?
And then it wasn't until Captain Marvel in 2018 as well, or 2019, that we had the first female led.
Yeah.
Movie.
So rightly so, the article. And I'll shoot her a link so she can listen to us and probably hopefully help us out and get us. Yeah, never mind. But the article was really great because it took back the phrase.
Yes,
it took back the phrase and was like, I can't remember exact words how the article ended, but it was very close to like, I for one can't wait for more of the MCU, and I was like, yeah fuck yeah,
fuck them, take it back, yeah.
Woo! Yeah, I was pretty excited because that should be what it is.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. But it's the same people that are shitbags that talked about this movie. That's my long box transition.
Are we going to do a thing?
What?
Hang on.
What? What's in your pocket? He's reaching something. You got to get that close to the mic. There it is. Yeah.
I'm blowing up your microphone, man.
Transition.
Transition.
So I watched on Friday. I watched Prey, and then Saturday I watched Lightyear, and I really liked Lightyear. I thought it was a fun movie. It wasn't like top tier Pixar, but it was a fun, enjoyable.
Watch that piece of garbage. I heard Tim Allen didn't like it, so I steered clear.
Exactly.
I fucking listen to whatever that guy says.
This is a movie just like Turning Red that is another movie.
Trying to fucking groom my kids?
Yeah, pretty much. By the way, the gay character isn't in the movie that much. What? And guess what? Sorry, Tyler. Spoilers if you want to watch this movie. It's a trope. They use her as a trope. She's gay and dies. That's what this... That if you want to go with that, if you want to be angry about this movie and that angle of having a lesbian couple, why not be mad about the gay character dying? But again, it makes sense within the context of the story and the narrative, so I understand why they did it, and it's really sad when it happens. But my point being, that she doesn't even kiss the other woman. You barely see, it's a brief second. And because of that, a bunch of people didn't want to see this movie and because they're idiots, one, and two, they're bigoted. And I think that's another reason why this movie flopped, because when I watched it, I was like, this is a very inoffensive, fun kids movie. Why do people got to bring stupid shit into it?
Because it's their own bullshit that they're putting everywhere.
It's this anti-fandom fuckheads who are like, you got to make everything political. When, again...
Hang on. Isn't it them who's making it political?
Exactly. That's my point. Is they made this movie political. There's no political... You want to know the themes of the Lightyear...
Wait a second.
You want to know the themes of the Lightyear movie? It is failure in dealing with it and self-doubt and regret and all these other themes. Mm. And no point does it have any agenda other than, okay, that character's gay.
Mm.
And they keep talking about Disney's not-so-secret gay agenda. You know what it is? It's putting gay characters in movies so kids aren't confused when they meet gay people, because gay people, whether you like it or not, are a part of our society.
Yeah.
And it's better to get used to them existing and not being fucking weird around them.
Hey, can I just, if you are one of those grifters or one of those people who follow those grifters, can I just put it to you like this? I'm totally a LGBTQ plus ally, okay? You know what's never happened to me, Jake, because I support that?
You're gay?
What's never happened to me is two guys showing up at my door going, hey, do you mind if we have anal sex in your living room?
Well, that's what... Sorry, because that would be one hell of a way to answer the door.
No, but... Don't you think that this is what these people think is going to happen if you allow these people... Like, what is your... What do you really think is going to happen?
If you're going to act that way about two people of the same sex kissing, then you should act the same way when there's any characters kissing at all in a kid's movie, right?
Because if you find... If there's any sexuality at all... No, but if it's hetero, it's okay. Yeah, because you want to keep your fucking kids in those stupid fucking norms no matter what they want with their lives. And it's not your life. It's their lives,
hey man,
you motherfucker.
You're getting on my long box, bro.
I'm just really...
That being said, Lightyear is a very fun movie.
I'm pointing at you because you happen to be the thing across from me.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry, bro.
No, it's true.
It's
stupid. We are in 2022, and this whole movie got sabotaged because... And this isn't the only example of this movie didn't make money. I think there's some people that were still confused by it and being like, is it a Toy Story movie, isn't it? And all this other stuff. But to think a portion of the box office was hurt because these people are idiots.
Yeah.
And maybe people were waiting for it to get on Disney Plus. I don't know. But that whole narrative about this movie is so wrong, because it's a fine movie. It's a fun movie. It's a
fun little kids movie. And yeah, why do you fuck kids got to tarnish it up?
The people that bitch about things being political make it political, because that's how they make their money. They're fucking grifters.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry if you don't watch my 12 and a half minute video explaining why they're grifters, but you would rather watch 2.5 minutes.
This is why we have to make our videos like 2.5 minutes. Hey, fuckheads, you're wrong. Click, done. You know, just like, okay, we get our point across, like, within 2.5. Because people are so...
Yeah. But I think...
I weep for the future.
You should watch... Honestly, I think I liked... Because I watched Toy Story right after that, the first one. I think I liked Lightyear more because of it. Because...
I think I'm going to check out Lightyear, because I have all the Lego sets.
If you can go in... It's fun to just go in and think of it as, like, okay, so this is the movie that Andy watched that made him want that Buzz Lightyear toy. Which is a cool idea. I think it's a cool concept. And then
you know what's a cool concept? Jake Williams.
Thanks, man. thanks so much for listening to this episode, number 59.
What a way to end it.
Yeah, what a way. Talk about how great Jake is. We'll see you next week. Next week's going to be a special episode because I will be out of town next week. Mm. So we are going to have another commentary.
Ooh.
Episode. And since we watched Prey...
Mm.
It's only fair that we watch the first Predator.
Oh.
You son of a bitch.
You kicked up a stone and dropped us in the meat grinder.
If you don't like us doing Arnold and Jesse Ventura, then do not watch this or listen to this commentary.
I'll tell you what, I watched that movie, and that Amber Midthunder was something. I'll tell you.
I tell you, she did. She doesn't have time to bleed. She's great.
That's why Jesse Ventura is
the
greatest.
No, hold on. Let me pull it up.
Yeah, let's hear it.
I want to read you the whole tweet because it's a very sweet.
Yeah, let's read the tweet. For those of you who are not aware, we used to do this show called
Panel Off Conspiracy.
No, it was it was Tinfoil Radio, and one of our special guests was always Jesse Ventura. Not really. We actually did reach out to his people and never heard back. I wonder why.
Prey movie was a great, great film. At Amber Midthunder, you definitely ain't got time to bleed. Excuse me. Welcome to the... That was me. I burped. Jesse did. It says burp in the... No, I'm kidding. Welcome to the Predator family. Danny... Is it Trenchenberg?
Dan Trachtenberg.
Danny Trachtenberg. Thank you for making a very thoughtful, creative, and wonderful film.
Aw.
Yeah, it was sweet.
Who did they respond?
Yeah, both Amber Midthunder and the director retweeted it and was like, oh my God, thank you for saying that. Where's Arnold at?
I do want to say that the music was really good too. I can't remember who it was. I want to say Sasha something, but the person who did the music was really good. Because she combined, I think it's a she, but they combined like different native like instruments and that kind
of you kind of almost hear a war drum in the background a lot.
Right, but there were electronic elements to it also that kind of that blend of whatever and a little bit of Old West too.
Well, Bucko, I think it's time for curtains on this episode.
Time for me to take a smoke and have a piss. I mean,
and touch myself.
Take a piss and have a smoke. That's what I meant.
Yeah. You know who doesn't have time to bleed?
Huh.
Stan Lee.
And that's it.
Off panel, off topic with Jake and Tyler.